Hey dudes, Hardcore Kid here. Hardcore enough to review kid stuff. And I'm in a good badass mood today. Call it a good ass mood if you want. Because just the other day, I saw the Avengers. And it was hardcore! Yeah, but in all seriousness, I really enjoyed this movie. It was an action-packed, adrenaline-fueled thrill ride with some of Marvel's biggest heroes. Iron Man, Captain America, Thor, Hulk, you name them. Which leads me into today's review. You see, Huey Toonmore asked me to take part in a video collaboration where a bunch of reviewers watch and critique Godzilla films. And since many of my fellow reviewers unknown happened to be taking part, I decided to join in on the fun. And I got myself a real behemoth to review. Godzilla's 9th appearance on the silver screen, a movie magnificently entitled, Destroy All Monsters. What makes this movie unique? Well, just like the Avengers, this movie features all your favorite giant movie monsters up until 1968. You've got Godzilla, Rodan, Angulus, Gorgosaurus, Mothra, Manda, Baragon, Manila, Varan, and Kumanga. That's enough awesomeness to make buildings blow up! But can this team-up of monsters be considered the Avengers of monster movies? Well, let's find out. This is Destroy All Monsters. Cue the theme music! We start off at the United Nations Scientific Complex in the futuristic world of 1999, where we see this ugly-looking rocket ship blasting off to a military base on the moon. After the title sequence, we cut to an island where Godzilla, Rodan, Angerus, Gorgosaurus, and a baby Mothra are being kept. The island is called Ogasara, but it's also referred to as Monster Land. Hey kids, love Godzilla? Looking to make the moves on Mothra? Like rocking out to Rodan? Then come to Monster Island and see your favorite monsters live, angry, and ready to rumble. Warning, Monsterland is not responsible for any injuries, amputations, mutations, deaths, or human centipedes. This message has been brought to you in part by Dr. Pepper. Drink it slow. Dino's orders. The island also houses an underground military base where we're introduced to our human characters. Our hero is Captain Katsuo. The girl here is his sister Kyoko. But we didn't come to see the human characters. Fuck no. We want to see the monsters. Nobody ever really cares about these guys, do they? Especially since the dubbing is about as solid as vitamin water.
I've been very worried about you on that island.
You have, huh? You can see that everything's fine.
Right. I really wasn't worried about you. I was more worried about Godzilla.
Yeah, classic poorly synced Japanese cheese for you. No good.
No good.
No good. No good.
Now here's the thing. There were actually two different dubs for this movie. One by Toho, and another by American International Pictures. During the 70s and 80s, the AIP version was on TV quite a bit. Orion got the right to release it on video, but never did because of bankruptcy. In the late 90s, ADV released the international dub to video. However, this version did not contain the superior AIP dub until eventually Media Blasters was granted the rights to release it to DVD and Blu-ray, along with some special features, HD transfer, and audio commentary, and as a special gift, they tracked down the international dub, fixed it as best as they could, and released it as an extra audio feature.
And I ended up with the Toho dub. Thanks a lot, Morgan.
So for whatever reason, there's a gas leak, and all the personnel and equipment are knocked out. The monsters end up escaping the island and wreaking havoc all around the world. Rodan attacks Moscow, Mothra going after Beijing, Baragon in Paris, and Manda in London. Lastly, we have the star of the show, Godzilla, attacking New York City.
Jesus, he looks pissed. Don't tell me he saw the 1998 remake.
Oh, once I find that Roland Emmerich, I'm gonna chop him up into fish sticks and use his blood as dipping sauce.
Cut to the meeting room at the United Nations where we're introduced to Dr. Stevenson, one of the very few English actors in the movie.
Doctor, what do you think has caused this?
How did the monsters escape?
Couldn't you foresee this?
We are not trying to conceal anything from you.
The truth of the matter, gentlemen, is that we don't know what has happened.
I have no idea why my voice is dubbed into English, when I am in fact English.
Cut to a shuttle in space where Harold and Kumar here suddenly spot a flying saucer moving past their dashboard. They follow it back to Monsterland, where Dr. Otani shows footage of each of the escaped monsters.
You let all the monsters loose when the chief was gone.
No, you're wrong. We're controlling them from here.
Remote control?
We want to call these monsters back. It's a simple process.
So this guy has complete control of the monsters, and he's using them to destroy major cities and kill a bunch of innocent people? Yeah, something's a little fishy.
That's a lot of fish.
Oh, shut up, Roderick! Jeez, enough of the 1998 remake. Let's stick to this movie, damn it. So the team is led into a large room where we meet a girl in a sparkly white bodysuit who's supposed to be an alien. Okie dokie.
It is my dream to build a new scientific civilization on Earth with the help of you people. In order to build this scientific civilization, we have to sacrifice some lives.
What's that?
Okay, so the alien, or Keylock as she calls herself, is explaining that she's using the monsters to destroy the current civilization and make their own. Oh, come on! Haven't these aliens ever heard of sharing a planet? It's always the same cliché. A bunch of aliens invade Earth, create a bunch of chaos, and try to claim the planet as their own. Isn't there any other planet they could invade, like Saturn or Pluto? Oh yeah, I forgot. Pluto ain't a planet. So gas starts pouring into the lab again, and we see some scientists, hypnotized by the Keylocks, firing at our heroes. Interesting how the guys who aren't wearing masks aren't suffocating from the gas. Well, if the gas doesn't kill you, bullets will! So Katsuo and the crew take Dr. Otani and bring him back to the ship. Back at the headquarters, Otani is interrogated, but in his brainwashed state, says nothing. And then he jumps out a window and kills himself. Adios, amigo. So Kyoko, who's also brainwashed by the Keylocks, is about to capture our heroes until the special police show up and scare them off. After checking the bodies, the scientists discover all these weird transmitter things planted by the Keylocks.
Is this how he controlled the monsters?
Possibly, Otani. The monsters were being controlled by the same device.
That's right. And those Keylock people were probably afraid that we'd find out about this.
God damn it, I don't care about these guys. Where are the monsters? Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Godzilla and Rodan doing what they do best, leveling a bunch of empty toy buildings and making things explode. Only this time, they brought along a friend.
Madness arrived.
That's right, it's Atragon's Manda, the big slimy sea monster who's joined forces with the other kaiju to create more mayhem. Time to bring in the big guns! Too bad the Japanese have really shitty aim. So with Tokyo in ruin for the 27th time, Kyoko tells Katsuo about a base in Aizu where the Keylocks have relocated. Once they get there, the crew tries to hover into a chasm, only for Godzilla to appear. Now, I have a little query. I understand Godzilla being indestructible, but has anybody ever wondered how our big spiky friend is able to move to different locations in a matter of days? He started out on Monster Island, swam to New York City, then came back to Tokyo, and now he's in Aizu? Huh. As big as he is, I doubt his top speed of 2 miles an hour would be able to transport him to all those different places so quickly. That is, unless he flies Air Rodan.
Angulus. Angulus.
Why that?
Oh, howdy, Angulus. Good to see you join the party. Here, play with my toy tank. It explodes real nice when you squeeze it.
Wow. That came out wrong, didn't it?
So after another near-death encounter with Godzilla, Katsuo, Ogata, and Tada find the entrance to the base, where they come face-to-face with the Keylocks, who prove that they're aliens by showing them the inside of their base. Behold, the Keylock Big Screen TV!
So now you're convinced that we're from outer space.
That's right. What do you have on your mind?
Peace terms.
peace terms.
I want Major Tata to listen with care. The Earth does not belong to you people. Fuji's secret underground area belongs to every man, woman, and child in the Kilak race. And if you fools intrude on us anymore, you'll die.
Well, aren't you going to kill them anyway? I mean, what are you going to do with the humans after they've surrendered? Enslave them?
Great! Just what we needed! The Ku Kilox clan!
Back at Monsterland, Dr. Yoshida learns that the mechanism used to control the monsters is in a moon base. So now it's back to the moon! Again! The team finally makes it to the moon base, and with the power of pyrotechnics and cheap laser beams, the base is destroyed. And the aliens just... fall down. Kilo babes are falling down, falling down, falling down. Kilo babes are falling down. Oh yeah, baby. So the team enters the base, only to find it to be a colored projection or something, and finds that the girls have been turned into rock sperm creatures that go into these weird-looking moon rocks. They find the transmitter and decide to use a solar gun and... wait a minute. You have to actually cut the case open to get the gun? Ever heard of a lock? So Katsuo is able to use the gun to disconnect the transmitter. And now the scientists have regained control of the monsters. But back on Earth, Godzilla has invaded Tokyo again, according to the stock footage shown from several scenes earlier. But now, with the monsters back under their control, the crew is ready to take out the Kilok base at Mount Fuji. What I find really hilarious is the color commentator they just randomly have for the fight. They might as well have Michael Buffer introduce the monsters.
Both Godzilla and Mothra are in the same area. Now we can see Angelus. Angelus is approaching from the left. Coming next are Manda, Baragon, Dorosaurus, and Spiga's there. Now Rodan's here. We can see him in the background.
Let's get ready to crumble!
With the monsters all lined up to fight, the Kiloks unleash their secret weapon, the three-headed Ghidorah.
Godzilla will lead these monsters in mortal combat, and I'm sure they'll win.
Wait. I would add Mortal Kombat music for this scene, but I think that meme's been a bit overused. So instead, I'm gonna add this music.
Jesus!
Christ.
Jesus! Jesus! Jesus!
Who are you? What have you sacrificed?
Jesus!
Superstar!
Who you think you're, what they say you are?
Jesus!
Superstar!
Who you think you're, what they say you are?
There was five of them! It took five of them! Justice Payne! Oh, Hate Club! The Hate Club's dead! Nick Gage! Nate Hatred! Who do you think you are? Nobody does this to Zandig! Nobody does this to the White Beater! Zandig, White Beater, Nick Mondo! We are the most ultraviolet force on the face of the Earth! Oh my! Oh! Yo, you're gonna die! You are gonna die! I guarantee it! I am gonna kill you!
So Ghidorah has been defeated, but uh-oh, a wild Moltres appears! The island base is then attacked by the flame monster, which causes the lab inside to spontaneously combust with explosions and weird colors. Seriously, I don't care if the movie came out in 68. Changing the screen filter does not make your explosions look cooler. It looks like the Kiloks now have the upper hand. But here comes Godzilla to settle the score for good, blasting fire at the base entrance before deciding, yeah, fuck that shit. I'm kicking your door down. So the base collapses on itself and the Kiloks are soundly defeated. But what about the fire dragon? Katsuo decides to take suicidal measures by shooting it out of the sky with his ship. First, he fires cooling missiles at it, and then starts giving it a crazy horseback ride. When the fire dragon is revealed to be a flying saucer, Katsuo promptly shoots it into the ground.
We did it!
And
so the movie ends with Dr. Yoshida, Katsuo, and Kyoko riding in a helicopter overlooking all the monsters now back in Monsterland, including Varon? Gee, was he even in this movie at all? And everybody all lived happily ever after. At least until that god-awful Godzilla's revenge. Ugh. This movie was a little underwhelming. For the most part, the monster effects are good, with the exception of a few flying scenes, and it is cool to see this big team-up of monsters together. I only wish I could say the same for the rest of the movie. The premise is decent, but the biggest issue I have is that the whole plot seems to revolve more around the aliens and barely on the monsters. And you'd think they'd focus on the monsters more since there are about 10 of them here. Which leads me to another problem. The actual use of the monsters. Godzilla, Rodan, and Mothra get the most screen time, while the others are mostly there for backup or just there for the sake of being there. It's like the Expendables movies where you cast big-time action stars like Bruce Willis and Arnold Schwarzenegger and just have them in there as afterthoughts. It isn't a bad movie in any way, the final fight scene is actually really awesome, but I just wish the film had more to it.
It isn't a hardcore headache, but it's not a hardcore hit. It's more of a hardcore bitch slap. It's okay, but not amazing.
Another little interesting fact. Because of the low ticket sales of Godzilla vs. the Sea Monster and Son of Godzilla, Tomioki Tanaka, creator and executive producer for all the Godzilla films from 1954 to 1995, had originally planned to have Destroy All Monsters be the final Godzilla movie. But thanks to its high ticket sales, the Godzilla series continued until it eventually retired from 1975 to 1984. Today, the Godzilla film franchise has long since retired, but there's still a lot to check out, like action figures, posters, even video games. In fact, there are actually two fighting games called Godzilla Destroy All Monsters Melee and Godzilla Unleashed, where you play as all of your favorite kaiju and beat the living shit out of everything. If you're lucky enough to find these games, get them. They kick all kinds of ass.
Well, I've done my part for this Godzilla collaboration. Tune in next time for more hardcore episodes of Hardcore Kids Movies. I'm the Hardcore Kid. Peace out.